Well, good morning, everybody. My name is, we're a little bit late already. My name is Hans van der Hoeve, and on behalf of the organizing committee here, I welcome you all to this second meeting point. After the success of the first one in 2012, we chose another subject this year, and it is using physiology to personalize mechanical ventilation. Now, for those of you, and I think that's nice, for those of you who've never been in Nijmegen before, you're actually in the oldest city in the Netherlands now. You all believe it's Amsterdam, but it's not, it's Nijmegen. And Nijmegen was already there in the beginning of our era. It was an outpost of the Roman Empire, and it was those in those days called Oporum Batavorum. And although when you walk through the city, you don't find the remnants and the remains of that period, I think we're still very proud of that period here in Nijmegen. We do have this year a very tight schedule, and it's a busy program, but my weather app tells me that at the end of the day it's going to be lovely weather. So I hope you find the time to visit our lovely city, and I'm pretty sure that you will enjoy it. A lot has happened since our first meeting in 2012, and I will pick out three things that happened in the literature that will be related to the topic of today. And the first one we learned in the last 3 years that the size of the tidal volume is also very important, I guess, in assistant ventilation. And we learned something about Pendelhoeft. And for those who are not familiar with Pendelhoeft, I can show you that Pendelhoeft is the movement of air inside the lungs from one area, the upper zone, to the non-dependent zones in a patient who doesn't start breathing yet. So here you can see that this is the volume of the lung in different parts of the lung, upper parts over here, middle part over here, lower parts over here, and you can see that in the beginning of an assisted breath the air is actually moving from the upper parts, it's decreasing here and increasing here. And that could be one of the explanations of ventilator-induced lung injury in assisted ventilation. The other thing that we learned is the concept of dynamic strain. There were a lot of animal studies, at least, that showed that dynamic strain may be one of the most important reasons for ventilator-induced lung injury. And a recent study in the New England Journal of Medicine, they didn't use actually dynamic strain, but had a nice substitute for it, I would say. The driving pressure also shows that in human, that may be the case. Here you can see identical PEEP levels with an increasing driving pressure, and you can see that mortality actually increases in those cases. So with static strain, nothing happens, identical static strain, and if dynamic strain increases, it may increase mortality. If static strain increases, but dynamic strain is actually the same, you see that there is no difference in mortality. And if static strain increases and dynamic strain actually decreases, you see a decrease in mortality. So a lot of things point to dynamic strain being one of the most important reasons for ventilator-induced injury. And then, of course, the third thing that we learned, we saw many, many studies in the literature on NAVA, showing at least that it is feasible in many clinical situations. And I think that is at least very important. We started to use it in clinical practice, and in most cases it worked out nicely. We also showed, and finally found a little bit, what the optimal idea of assistance would be in different clinical situations. Now this is a study from Liu, recently from critical care, showing some physiology of NAVA, in which case the patient ventilator breath contribution was actually shown to correlate very well with some measures that you can take with NAVA. In this case, the relationship between the tidal volume and the peak AD signal in assisted and non-assisted breath. So we started to learn for the physiology from NAVA also. Now, the title of this theme, I would say, using physiology to personalize mechanical ventilation, I think that's the right way to go. Here you see a typical patient, one of our COPD patients, in which we titrated extrinsic PEEP towards intrinsic, measured intrinsic PEEP to improve the ventilator, patient ventilator syncope. And in this case, it worked very well. And I personally believe that personalized medicine will be a major assist, I would say, to our randomized controlled trials that we're having in the ICU. We've seen many trials failing in the ICU, and part of this can be explained, of course, by personalization, I would say. And I think if we are able to personalize medicine, it may prevent another bucket full of negative trials in the next 10 years. And that will certainly also be the case for mechanical ventilation, I would say. A large part of this, a large part of the lectures and of this Congress will be on three topics. First of all, we will try to see what the function of the respiratory muscles actually is. We will talk a lot about NAVA, of course, and the third thing is that we will talk a lot about a patient ventilator syncope. And we are really very glad that we have the experts in the field, the world experts and the leading experts in the field here available today in Nijmegen. And they will give you the latest research, of course, their latest research, and they will also give you an insight in the future of mechanical ventilation. A large part, like I said, will be dedicated to patient ventilator asynchrony. And here, once again, you have a patient with a COPD, and you see, you see missed breath, of course, over here. You see delayed cycling on, you see problems with cycling off. And there is mounting evidence in the literature that this relates with clinical outcome. We're not sure yet, but it could very well be. This is a recent study from Blanche from 2015. We looked at the amount of asynchrony for the whole ICU period. And although they probably underestimated the amount of asynchrony because they didn't use the signal of the diaphragm and they didn't use a transesophageal catheter, they could show that there was a relation, at least between an association between the amount of asynchrony and outcome. And it appears to be the case that a lot of asynchrony is at least associated with an increased length of stay and even with more important outcome measures. And the evidence is only weak, and of course this is not a causal relationship, but it would be very nice to investigate it in this in a nice future. Matters, I think, are even worse in non-invasive ventilation, and I think we all realize that. This is a study from our own department, and you can see that the amount of this syncope with a dedicated non-invasive machine is actually huge. And when we used the typical ICU ventilator, it was still very huge. And when we changed from pressure support to NAVA, you see the tremendous decrease in the amount of this syncope. So this is probably not a coincidence. The next slide I received from Jennifer Beck, and she looked at all the studies in the literature that compared syncope and asyncope between NAVA and conventional ventilation in adults and here in infants. And in the end, you see that the amount of asynchrony in NAVA is about 5%, and you see that the amount of asynchrony in the other studies is about 26%. So a huge difference between the two. And I think most of us who work with NAVA in everyday practice, they recognize it. And it's not strange for them anyway. But on the other hand, it shows us that NAVA is not yet perfect. It's definitely not. And for example, double triggering may be a little bit more prevalent with NAVA than with the other modes. So this brings me to the future of mechanical ventilation. Of course, when there is a lot of asynchrony and dyssynchrony present, and we know that it is maybe related with outcome and that we can improve it with NAVA, this will probably push us to doing randomized controlled trials between NAVA and the conventional modes. And I think you will hear the first results from those trials in this meeting. But on the other hand, I'm pretty well convinced that a lot of those trials may actually fail unless we titrate NAVA and conventional ventilation on an individual basis. It will be very necessary to show important clinical outcomes for NAVA, I would say. Well, this brings me to the end of this start. First of all, we're going back to our theme, using physiology to personalize mechanical ventilation. I think we will have a very stimulating and interesting meeting. There are one additional thing that I have to tell you, and that for tonight, there are still limited numbers of additional tickets available at the registration office. So if you want to do that, please go there during the first break. And then, because of time's sake, I would say it would be nice to start the first session on respiratory muscle functioning.